Guten Tag, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, liebe
Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues,
and a good morning to all of you in North America.
My name is Aubrey Pomerance. I'm the head of the archive at the Jewish Museum Berlin, and I'm also the head of the dependents of this archive, of the archive of the Leo Baeck Institute, New York, here in the Jewish Museum in Berlin. And I welcome you on behalf of both institutions. I warmly welcome you to this first panel of the Shared History Conference, 1,700 years of Jewish life in German-speaking lands. With me on this stage are my colleagues Inka, Bertz and Tamar, Lewinsky, and my colleague Theresa couldn't come here today as was planned, but she is going to join us online. So, needless to say, we would have preferred to have this event live with you, the audience, with us in this room. So it wasn't possible, unfortunately, and I hope that you're all well in those difficult times. Fortunately, the Jewish Museum Berlin was able 3.5 months ago to open the new permanent exhibition after 5 years of intensive work. The exhibition presents history and culture of the Jews in Germany from the beginnings to the present day in four big rooms, and these four big rooms are separated into several topics that highlight specific aspects of Jewish life beyond the borders of Germany. The four rooms have the topics of Jews in the context of their surrounding societies, and inclusion and exclusion are the big poles around which the stories of Jewish history are told in this permanent exhibition. And of course, in every historical epoch, the criteria and the conditions for inclusion and exclusion within the community and from the side of the host society is negotiated anew. So all the subjects that are going to be debated over the 2 days in all the panels and groups during this conference are also part of the permanent exhibition. And we think that this is the most relevant exhibition on the topic of 1,700 years of Jewish life in German-speaking lands. And the exhibition on the 58 object is going to take place next year, and it's hopefully going to be with us for many more years to come. And we're also looking forward very much to welcoming you, the audience, back into the rooms of our museum, hopefully soon. So we're going to talk about some of the objects here today. Overall, in the permanent exhibition, we have more than 700 exhibits, and we also borrow some exhibits from other institutions, for example, the Leo Baeck Institute, and Inka Bertz is going to tell us more about one of these objects in her presentation. Inka is the head of the collection of this house, and she's the curator for art, and she talks about Darb's painting of the bust of Moses Mendelssohn, the ban on images, the reception of antiquity, and media history. Thank you very much for this introduction. Welcome, everybody. It's a really strange situation to be talking to you through cameras instead of face-to-face. So it's not a new thing that a conference is opened by the Jewish Museum with the topic of Moses Mendelssohn. It leads us back to the first years of our institution. So the topic Moses Mendelssohn is a symbol of a shared history in the double sense. I could have another presentation about that interesting topic on another occasion. Today I want to talk about a specific object. This object is a painting. It was painted in 1786 by Darbus, a portrait painter from Berlin. And on this painting you see the bust of Moses Mendelssohn made by Jean-Philippe Tassin. Theresa. This painting is part of the art collection of the Leo Baeck Institute, which organizes this conference. Since the opening of the Jewish Museum, so for almost 20 years now, we are lucky enough to be able to present this painting to our audience, and it opens our exhibition on Haskalah and Salon. So today I have the opportunity to thank the colleagues from New York for their trust in lending us this unique object for such a long time. And we want to highlight the object's history, the history of its painter, when it was painted, and of course I want to tell you something about the bust that was painted here and how it was received back then and in the aftermath. The Leo Baeck Institute received the painting from Julius Held, an art historian and an expert in Dutch painting. He donated the painting in remembrance to his sister Ida Bloch, who had emigrated to Israel. He had bought it on the art market in New York, and back in the middle of the 19th century, it was still in the collection of the Prince of Hohenzollern-Hechingen in Schlesien-Löwenberg. But this collection was dissolved in 1890 and sold. So this provenance leads us straight ahead to the unusual women who were moving around in the society of Mendelssohn in the middle of the 1780s. We are speaking about the Salonier Dorothea von Kurland and her half-sister, the writer Elisa von der Recke. They corresponded with Mendelssohn, and Dorothea invited Mendelssohn to her castle in Friedrichsfelde. And Dorothea's daughter then married somebody from the Hohenzollern-Hechingen family. So this is how the painting then probably got to Löwenberg. The painter, Johann Friedrich Dabes, had lived in Russia for a long time before he came in Berlin in 1785 and became a member of the Academy and a professor for portrait painting in Berlin. He was in close touch with the aristocracy in Kurland and also with the Jewish upper class in Berlin. 1786, Dabes was very busy and displayed famous portraits, and he also displayed a painting of a marble bust. So maybe that's already our painting, and maybe the skull on the painting that was discussed back then was a reference to the Phaedon. So maybe our painting, our object, was commissioned by one of the two ladies I already talked about, one of the two fans, so to say, of Mendelssohn. What we know is that the marble bust was financed by 20 friends of Mendelssohn. They donated 400 thalers to the sculptor Jean-Pierre Tassart, who was the royal court sculptor back then, and all of these 20 friends received a little plaster cast version of this marble bust as a thank you. So maybe the painting was a replacement of the three-dimensional bust, and maybe it was one of the two princesses, after all, who commissioned the bust and the painting. And that would be very interesting, because usually crowdfunding for art back then was only carried out by men. The bust shows Mendelssohn with a kind of toga. It's a quote of antique portraits, and the inscription on the pedestal by the poet Ramler also evokes the vision of the Socrates of Berlin, which was back then a widely known perception of Mendelssohn. It's quite unusual that Mendelssohn allowed himself to be portrayed in a three-dimensional bust back then. It's the first three-dimensional bust we know of a Jew that was made during the lifetime of this person. On the pedestal, we read that this that the portrait philosopher Mendelssohn was true to the laws of the forefathers. The Haskalah brought about a very interesting portrait culture, paintings, sketches, engravings, but that was similar to the art scene in New York, Venice, or Amsterdam. But in no other city were there any busts from the Jewish upper class. Mendelssohn went one step further. He decided that it is not relevant whether an image is two-dimensional or three-dimensional. The decisive thing for him was that there is a ban on worshipping images. You should not see images as an idol. That's the central thing. That's what he found important. But he didn't mind if the image itself was two-dimensional or a three-dimensional bust. He thought that art belonged to a different sphere. And among the 20 friends who financed this bust were also Jews, and they obviously agreed with him. And the bust was then erected in the Jewish free school.
Doch kehren wir zurück zum Bild des Sokrates und der Antikisierung.
So let's go back to the idea of Socrates and the perception of Mendelssohn as a kind of antique figure. 785, this style was quite popular. The director of the Academy, Frisch, had Mendelssohn painted in grisaille in the style of an antique cameo. So the reduced colors of this grisaille painting influenced Darb's painting because he also uses a lot of gray. He certainly knew the previous painting. In 1784, it was on the cover of Zöllner's book about Mendelssohn called Jerusalem, and later also on the Mendelssohn biography. After Mendelssohn's death in 1786, the cameo portrait became extremely popular, and also Tassard's bust. The son of Tassard spread copies, lithographies of the bust and the painting, and there were little miniature porcelain figures of the bust sold. So the bust of Tassar and the paintings determined how people saw Mendelssohn in the decades after his death. But then they were forgotten, just as what Mendelssohn was forgotten. In the next century, he was marginalized as a popular philosopher, and classicism also became less relevant and was replaced by more national forms of art and aesthetics. Mendelssohn was only remembered at the 100th anniversary of his birth. But the audience then didn't want antique portraits anymore, but they wanted more naturalistic portraits. So the Mendelssohn portraits of Anton Graf and the second portrait by Frisch from 1783 were used as inspiration, but the new portraits were more naturalistic. And even on such images as the one you see here, you had the Mendelssohn portrait in profile. And this is the miniature you see here. Thank you very much for your attention. So we agreed that the three presentations are going to start our panel. There's going to be one presentation after the other, and then we will hopefully have questions about all three presentations. The second presentation is going to be given by my colleague Theresa Ziehe. She is the curator for photography here in the Jewish Museum, She's going to talk about a series of photos that belongs to the room Catastrophe, the years between 1933 and 1945. Her presentation has the title Photographing in Spite of Danger, Werner Fritz Fürstenberg's Photos of Anti-Semitic Signs in Nazi Germany. I welcome you very warmly.
I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to make a presentation, and I would like to share it with you now. I would like to repeat its title. It's Taking Photographs in Spite of Danger to Life, Werner Fritz Fürstenberg's pictures or photographs of anti-Semitic signs in Nazi Germany. And we can see 26 photographs. These are photographs of anti-Semitic signs, but also signs in showcases and shops. All the photographs were taken by Werner Fritz Fürstenberg, showing mostly rural areas. And he documented these signs in order to show how Jews were marginalized in that times. Werner Fritz Fürstenberg was the owner of the leather shops, Albert Rosenhain, together with his brothers. And after the boycott of April 1933, he intensified the export business. And in 1933, he opened a very successful subsidiary in Amsterdam, where he lived from then on. And he remained strongly associated to the headquarters in Berlin, and he traveled a lot between Amsterdam and Berlin. These photographs were probably taken during one of these journeys. The photographs arrived at the collection of the Jewish Museum of Berlin as a permanent loan by the son and the grandson of the photographer, by Thomas Alexander Fürstenberg, and I would like to extend my gratitude to them so that the photographs can be part of our collection, and I'm allowed to speak about them today. And when we prepared our permanent exhibition, we made intensive researches about the stock, and we looked into the photographs, examined them, and we had many different results. I would like to share them with you now, in short. Of course, we examined the question where the photographs were taken, and we have some hints on the photographs themselves. We see a sign Achtung, for example, on one of the photographs, and on the other two photographs we have the inscriptions Hildesheim and Heiseter. And on the right-hand side, on the top, you also see a train track, which was a very interesting hint, the course of this track. And we also have some buildings, houses that can be seen on the pictures, and they still exist. We also have some hints that Fürstenberg was driving a car, which can be seen on the photographs on the right side. On the bottom picture, there is just a small part of the car. And thanks to these hints, we could reconstruct his route. He drove from Berlin to the Netherlands, and he drove on the Reis Road number 6 through Bad Harzburg, Hildesheim, passing Hanover to Lübeck, and then to the Netherlands. Another important question was the date of the photographs. And we have some hint on the photographs themselves as well. You can see in the top row, we have some issues of the Stürmer, the paper, and they can be dated to August 1935. And we also have some further hints in nature. On the left side, on the bottom row, you can see a harvest car, or you can see the leaves on the trees, and these are all hints that refer to the end of the late summer, so we can assume that the pictures were taken in August 1935. It's also very interesting to have a look at the texts on the signs, because they show how brutal these signs were, because on the left-hand side you can see that Jews are not desired, or Jews have nothing to do in Arberg, or the contact to Jews means an exclusion from the community, or Jews have to take responsibility for their lives. And we also have a further sign on the right side that the department store opposite on the street belongs to the Jew David Boas, which is a personal defaming. It's very striking that you can also see what they are very different in the fonts, and this is a hint that they were locally written, and they also show how strong the marginalization of Jews was in the rural areas, especially. Anti-Semitism, marginalization, and discrimination were very decisive in the everyday lives of Jews, and they fled to bigger cities because being anonymous was a kind of help for them to establish a life. And the fact that the signs disappeared after 1935 shows that people escaped the rural areas. It's also very striking when we look at the signs and the photographs that there are no people on it, on them. So they are very scary, actually. And you maybe there are some exemptions. You can see two people here in front of the showcases showing their backs to the photographer. And on the right-hand side, you can see some people on bicycles that go away from the photographer. And this also suggests that there was a certain degree of risk when taking these pictures. So he had to be alone when he took these pictures, and he took a lot of photographs from the car, from the inside of the car. And you can see in the bottom next to the car, there is his fiancée with a dog. She's holding a dog, and it looks like a tourist photo. Yes, they use the dog so that they look like tourists. And a private Jewish businessman driving through rural areas without a protection, this means, or this shows, that there was very high risk at this very courageous action to him. The objective of these photographs is documentation and information. And Furstenberg had to take these pictures very quickly and not raising any attention. So he didn't want to have high quality images, but he wanted to have a large collection and a very wide range of these signs. And he was very sensitive towards the increasing marginalization of Jews in Nazi Germany, and therefore he was increasingly ready to document this these atrocities in spite of all the dangers. And he handed over copies of these photographs to the Central Jewish Information Office in Amsterdam, the predecessor of the current Wiener Library. And there is a collection of information about Nazi Germany and persecution, and there are some slideshows about this. We know that his photographs were used in 1935 and 1936 with distorted information in order to protect him, who was still in Germany, or in many cases in Germany. They renamed the routes he was driving along in, like, Düsseldorf, Berlin, for instance, and he was also described as a motorcycle driver from the Netherlands. And you can also see that the face of his fiancée was whitened so that her identity was protected as well. The photographs can be seen in the permanent exhibition in the context of National Socialism, presented in this double showcase on the right-hand side. On the left-hand side, in the same room, there is a big installation with a lot of examples of anti-Jewish measures, and we can also see a map, a violence map, which informs about anti-Semitic violent acts between 1933 and 1938 in Nazi Germany. In general, it was very important to us to show National Socialism from a Jewish perspective, so we used Jewish sources. And there were some exceptions, but mainly Jewish sources. And the photographs of Fürstenberg are a perfect example for that. Of course, we also have pictures of anti-Semitic signs from the perspective of the perpetrators, like in the midst of celebrations, village celebrations. But the fact that the Jewish businessman was successful in documenting marginalization with his camera is very decisive. And it makes this collection to a very specific document. On the last slide, you can see some sources and literature sources. So thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much, Theresa. In the 3.5 months when the museum was still open, or 2.5 months maybe, visitors were really fascinated of these pictures, of these photographs of Fürstenberg. And now we will listen to the third presentation by Tamar Lewinsky. She's curator for contemporary history in the museum, and together with Theresa Ziehe and Martina Lüdecker, she designed the room of the era where migration plays a central role. And collecting the history of migration, this is, or objects of migration, is the presentation's title. Thank you, Ari. With the immigration of Russian-speaking Jews from the former USSR, the Jewish community in Germany changed, basically, and migration does not only play a decisive role since the 90s. Directly after the war, East European displaced persons came to Germany, and a small part of emigrated German Jews came back to Germany, and small groups, small migration groups came back from, came from Poland, Hungary, and Iran. And in the last two decades, we have a very strong migration from Israel. So migration is not only part of German history, but it's a constitutive part of Jewish life in Germany after the Holocaust. This has not been reflected in our collections. So in order to close this gap, since 2016, we have a project in place titled Object Days. And the results of this project and how these are presented is described in my short presentation. The basic idea of the project, which is implemented together with Theresa Ziehe and Alina Kromova, we ask Jewish people to show us different objects that are linked to their migration story. And then, starting with these objects, we make interviews, we collect and take photographs of these objects. We also have our photographer Stefan Prammer with us, and he portrays all the participants together with their objects so that we can tell a story, and we already have a large gallery of different portraits, and we would like to integrate them into our collection and close the gap in this way. We also have similar formats with similar degrees of participation. This is a very good format that is very fitting for urban and rural historical museums. And Munich is the only city with a Jewish museum that has already put in place such a format with a temporary collection. The current status is that we have already carried out object days at 6 places with the participation of 100 people between the age of 20 and 90. The major part of participants came to Germany since 1990, but we also have objects from different migrations like Poland, Hungary, Israel, United States, Mexico, Belgium, and Morocco, just to name some of them. The project has not been evaluated and has not is not finished yet. This is only a short overview of it. Let's have a look at the roots of migration. Migration is reflected in different ways in biographies like remigration, serial migration, or professional mobility. And the reasons and the circumstances of migration are very diverse. They have different degrees of voluntariness, economic conditions, destinations, and of course, family structures play an important role as well. Let's have a look at 3 examples. The parents of this participant got to know each other in the English emigration, and together with their children born in England, they returned to Germany, to Dresden, to the home city of the birth city of the father. And this menorah and the medal tell the migration story of the parents. On one hand, the flight of persecution, and then the politically motivated return. Sometimes migration is a movement stretching over several generations. In the family of Leora Jaffe, the great-grandmother, grandmother, mother, and daughter do not live on the continent where they were born. And this embroidered tapestry is from the grandmother from Lithuania, who spoke 6 languages, and from there the family went to the United States over through South Africa, and then Leora Jaffe came to Germany with this tapestry. Vera Primakova had, we all know this kind of bag, and these bags are often linked to migration in a negative way as a Turkish suitcase. And in this bag, she took along objects that were very useless in her new life, but it was a symbol of transition, and she still keeps this bag since her emigration, so more than 20 years already. So the metaphor of the suitcase is very often used, and it symbolizes migration, that you have to leave the majority of your objects. So you can take only things that fit into the suitcase. So these objects have a very special significance. So if you look at objects of migration that are actually, the basis of biographic conversations show how important they are to these people. The object of migration that we've seen so far can be put into different categories. I just want to name some of them. It's not complete, of course. There are objects that describe the process of migration, like crossing a border or traveling, like passports or different documents from the hostel when people arrive. Other objects give a hint to the cultural context in their country of origin, like discs and books or souvenirs. We also have souvenirs from the family that originate from the family that are very important, like a traveling book from the 19th century, or jewelry, or last photographs that remain from the family. And these objects, of course, have a very strong symbolic function. These objects become Jewish due to their biography and their story, and also by the person that owns them, who owns them. But there are some other objects that are directly linked to Jewishness or family traditions, like a kosher pan that came along from Ukraine, or the traditional west of a rabbi. This was the daughter of a rabbi who migrated to Mannheim from France. The migration movement after 45 are one of the main topics of our permanent exhibition, and we examine the topic from different sides. If you look at the design, you can see that after 1945, there is a bridge leading through the room with different figures on it and dates about the development of Jewish life in Germany. So visitors are led through the room by this bridge. And as an antidote to these dry figures, you can watch films and footages from the past decades. And of course, these are private footages, so that you have a lot of personal evidence about migration. You have footages about displaced persons from the Czech Republic or from Romania and Iran. As one of the highlight topics, we have Russian-speaking Jews. Here you can see some objects that were given by them to the Jewish Museum. And here, of course, we present the objects together or link to their stories, migration stories. And in this way, they receive a different significance, a different meaning. They become historic objects or historical objects with a very strong significance, which goes beyond the personal value. And finally, I would like to tell you that in the coming years, we will have further object days. We want to collect objects and migration stories and make stories visible for our collection. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you, Tamar. This is a very fascinating picture of different objects. A part of them is already in our collection. Others are still in use. And now we have about 20 minutes. And well, actually, I don't really see all the questions on my iPad, so please, I would like to ask our technicians to give me some help, but I promise I will answer all your questions.
So let me begin with a question to Inka Bertz. Inka, what do we know about Mendelssohn's own attitude towards his portraits? Do we know how he liked them? And how often did he actually act as a model for portraits? And another question that came to my mind is that it's quite fascinating that Mendelssohn seems to be the first Jew in Germany who was a model for a bust. And I was asking myself whether that became a trend afterwards, whether other Jews after him, famous Jews, also had their three-dimensional images taken. Well, about Mendelssohn, we don't really know. He didn't really leave us any leave any texts about his opinion about his own portraits. But there were so many portraits painted. Gleim, paid for the first portrait of Mendelssohn, for the Friendship Temple, after Mendelssohn had become famous because of the Fiden. So since 1767, there's been almost a flood of Mendelssohn portraits. And Kodowiecki also painted him or made drawings of him. And this became popular because of a coin by Abramson. So we have several patterns, several kinds of portraits, and they formed various traditions and were more or less popular in their own time. And after the Fiden, miniatures became quite popular, but more for private households. So there were different fashions and trends and waves of popularity. So there must have been around 5 to 10 portraits that were taken during Mendelssohn's lifetime. But whether other Jews followed his example is really difficult to answer. I don't know of any other example. The bust that we had in the Jewish Museum in the entrance hall, where Mendelssohn was on one side and on the other side we had the bust of Max Klein, Abraham Geiger. I think that was a posthumous bust, and I think that there was no life model for this bust. It was probably done on the basis of photography. And of course, then in the modern era, we had busts of Einstein and Liebermann and all kinds of famous Jews. But that was later. Okay, we have a question about the second presentation by Theresa Ziehe. There was one very attentive member of the audience who we know watching us, but I'm not going to say the name. So the question to you, Theresa, is whether all the bicycles are moving away from the sign, or two of the bicycles are moving towards the photographer. Could be, yes. Maybe I was going too far in saying that all the bicycles are moving away from the photographer, but what was important to me is that they're all quite far away. So he didn't take photos when somebody was close by. That was my main point. Theresa, one more question about this. I was asking myself about diversity. It's something that we might not know. Did he take photos of all the signs that he saw, or were there other signs that he wasn't interested in because he had already taken similar photos and maybe he was trying to make a very diverse collection? Maybe he went through 50 villages with such signs, but he only took 30 pictures because the others were repetitive? Well, we don't know. I think there are two signs that were photographed twice. The others are all individual photos, and we know that so far we don't know where the original slides of these photos are. So we just had to accept the photos the way they were donated to us. We then tried to reconstruct the route, and we noticed that in some areas more signs were photographed than in other areas, but I don't know, or we don't know, for what reason Fürstenberg made his choices. Probably he was trying to capture a certain diversity. I guess that might be right. Tamar, how do these object days work in practice? How do you reach your target group, and how representative are the persons who participate in these projects? How representative are the objects they bring into it? Well, first question, it's a lot of work. Each time we organize such a project, we have to find the right framework for it, because we can't just go into the city and ask big groups. We have to contact individuals, but we have lots of people who help us with that in the communities, in educational institutions. But it's a lot of work, and we have lots of volunteers helping us with these projects, and without them we wouldn't be able to carry out all these interviews. It's a lot of logistic work, and that's why we're not as far as we would like to be at this stage. And at the same time, it's a big chance for us, because we get in touch with so many people in the communities, and we hope that we are going to stay in touch with the groups of people that we contact throughout the course of this project. And on the question of being representative or not, that's very difficult to say. We don't set any, well, we don't predefine the term migrational object. For us, it's not important what kind of object the participants bring in. We don't ask them whether they are halakhic Jews. We don't ask them whether they are an active part of a religious community or not. That's not relevant. Everybody who identifies as part of a Jewry with a view to their personal migration story is invited to participate. So our collections have lots of objects, and the majority of these objects are, of course, acquired or donated by persons who fled from Germany, and not so much people who came to Germany or re-migrated. You have some examples of people re-migrating and bringing things back from England, for example. So that's a multiple migration story. And these objects have crossed borders in both directions. So that poses interesting questions. What is the meaning of these objects during the course of a biography? And I think that because of this project, we also have the chance to open up a new field, research on Jews who have come to Germany after 1945 and who were not raised in the German cultural sphere. And we are very interested in that. Here I have another question. Is there going to be a recording of this panel? Yes. The Leo Baeck Institute and the Federal Agency for Civic Education are going to put this panel online. Of course, my colleagues are also invited to ask each other questions. Let me check if I have any more questions from the audience here. Theresa, one more question to you. You said that most of these photos were taken up to 35, and then many of these signs had vanished. And that could have something to do with Jews having already left the countryside and moved into the big cities. And many small towns, Jews made up 30 or 40% of the population only 60 or 70 years before, and then in after 1935, there were no Jews left in these small places. And maybe it also has something to do with the Olympics, because the Germans didn't want Germany to look bad in the face of a lot of international journalists coming to the country. We know, for example, that the Stürmer magazine's showcases disappeared during the time of the Olympics from many places. And we also talked about the fact that such signs were also talked about in the Jewish press, especially around that time. We have reports about that from April, May, June 1935 in Jewish newspapers. And that's very interesting because it means that these anti-Semitic acts were talked about in the public media. Do you have any thoughts on that? Yes, that's true, and it's confirmed by the slideshows of the Central Jewish Information Office, which date back to 35 and 36. So Fürstenberg might even have had a little, they might have asked him to take photos for these slideshows, but we don't know about that. So maybe it was his mission, so to say, to document the exclusion of Jews. Of course, after 35 and around 37, many of these signs had disappeared. Inka, would you like to say something? Yes, you offered us to ask each other questions, so I'm going to take up that offer and ask Tamar a question. So I want to comment on what you said about being representative or not. That question is quite important. Maybe you could say a little bit about the work in the museum. What's different between social research? What's the difference between social research, empiric social research, and museum work? Because in museums, we are not displaying representative social statistics. Maybe you could speak a little about the way you see an exhibition as being representative or not. Maybe some objects have become more frequent than others? That's not easy to answer because we are still evaluating the process and our findings. So I already mentioned some groups of objects that we have more often. We don't have so many travel documents. We have a lot of family memorabilia that are very important for the families. And we have lots of things that are not Jewish, because our big question is what makes an object Jewish? So at the moment, we're still looking at all these objects. We don't want to draw conclusions yet, but this is going to be the next step. We want to take some of these objects into our exhibitions at the museum, and then we're going to have to evaluate that more thoroughly. We'll have to evaluate how representative these objects are in highlighting certain aspects of migration and how can it be integrated into our collections. But these are questions that we're going to ask ourselves in the second phase of the project. We haven't reached this point yet and we're not hurrying because at the moment we want to stay open to what is brought to us. I have a question to Theresa. Do you have any proof or do you have any hints that the signs were removed by Jews as a form of resistance? Well, I don't know. Maybe, Aubrey, you can say something about that. Do you know anything about that? I think that in my presentation, I highlighted that it took a lot of courage to even take photos of these signs. It wasn't only journalistic work, but it was a visualization process that was dangerous in those times. The signs themselves say how brutal the spirit, the ruling spirit was. To be honest, I don't know either. I don't know about resistance groups taking down signs. Maybe we could find out a little bit about that in court records, but I think it's quite unlikely. Because I think that would have had very negative consequences for the Jewish groups, the repressions for Jewish groups in these places would have been extremely harsh. So I guess that nobody would have taken these signs down for reasons of resistance. Tamar, another question to you. What was the most spectacular object that you have received during the course of your Object Day project? Oh, that's very difficult to answer because, well, I have to say, if you participate in these Object Days and carry out these interviews, when you carry out the interviews, everything seems very spectacular because the stories are very interesting and very moving. So most of us really value these objects that we have talked about with their owners. I personally have one or two favorites. One is from a family of that re-migrated into Germany, a German family that had deep roots in Germany, and they have a so-called wanderer's book from the middle of the 19th century. They brought that to France. They were imprisoned in Gurs, and the parents married in Gurs in France. And then they went back to Germany and brought this book back to Germany. But there are other moving stories as well. For example, the evacuation to Central Asia. That's a dimension that opens up a totally different narrative. So I can't really answer your question because it's very closely linked to the stories. Well, I think one answer to that would be that the audience is also invited to make up their own minds about these objects. When it's possible to come to the Jewish Museum again and to visit our permanent exhibition, previously known as New Exhibition, but now it's our permanent exhibition. It's full of fascinating objects, so maybe you can come to the museum and make up your own mind. So now I'm going to close the first panel of this conference. I thank my colleagues Inka Bertz, Theresa Ziehe, and Tamar Lewinsky for their presentations. I thank you very much for your interest and for watching this panel, and I invite all of you to take a little break and then come back to watch the opening event here on this stage. It's going to have a keynote discussion on Jewish life today, a multitude of voices. The discussion is going to be moderated by Dr. Josef Joffe. He's going to talk to our museum director, Hetty Berg, and to Max Czolek, the writer. Thank you very much.